Hi everyone, and welcome to the GRUX SIG 2020 Census presentation. I hope you are all having a good GRUX Online conference, or if you're watching this as video on demand afterward, welcome as well. So for a brief introduction, for those of you who don't know me yet, hi, my name is Elizabeth Zelle, and I'm currently a member of your GRUX SIG steering committee. And it's in this role that I conducted this census survey, and so I'll be talking about the data today as well. And I'm also currently the user research manager over at Amazon Games. So a little introduction as to why we started running a census this year, because this is the first year that we've run a survey like this. So here's a little graph of our Discord membership, and this is information pulled from our Discord server insights. And it's looking at the length of time that people have been members of our Discord server. And what you will immediately see is that over 50% of our current membership as of early November has been a member of our Discord for up to a year. This is indicative to the steering committee that we're having a lot of growth, and growth is great. We're really excited about growth. But this also indicates to us that we probably don't have a great grasp on who all of our members are. This kind of growth is hard to keep up with as a steering committee. And so we're really interested in collecting some data. Who makes up our current community? Where is this growth coming from? And who does that growth represent? So kind of the objectives we had in running this census was, one, to get a better sense for who's currently making up our community, especially with all of that recent growth that we know has been occurring. We'd also like to kind of evaluate what existing SIG efforts are currently having the most impact and has the highest amount of awareness from our community, and also to help us identify potential areas for growth or improvement as we prioritize different projects within the SIG. So a little bit of overview of the data I'm going to be talking about today. The sample size for this survey was 113 participants, and this is data that was collected late April through early May of this year, 2020. I will note here that even though you're not seeing this data presented until November, the steering committee has had access to this data since the data was collected. So if you provided feedback in the census, it's already being taken into account. The information we got from it is already being reflected on by the steering committee and is already being used to inform decisions that the steering committee is making. Two additional notes, which is things that won't be included in this particular presentation. One, I'm not going to include any kind of analysis of the write-in box feedback. We had a lot of write-in boxes in the survey as well to collect some free form feedback about what the SIG is doing and how the SIG is meeting people's needs. But because the survey was anonymous and I'd like to try and protect the anonymity as much as possible, I'm not gonna be digging into any of the write-in feedback people provided for us. Additionally, as you'll see when we look at the data, only 13 people who identified as currently being students responded to the census. And because that sample size is so small, even though I did ask a few additional questions of that student group, I'm not gonna be doing a deep dive on the answers to those questions. Hopefully next year or in further years, that particular pool of respondents will be larger, and so we can do a little bit more of an analysis of what their needs and trends look like. So without any further ado, let's kind of dig into the data from the 2020 census. And as I note here, it's guaranteed to be 72% less exciting than the salary survey. So hopefully I'm not gonna be disappointing anyone. There's not gonna be any big surprises or really juicy information that's presented in this survey. All of it is pretty as we expected, to be honest. So no way am I gonna be living up to the excitement that salary survey data can bring. So first of all, how do people find the census? This is really important for the steering committee to understand both how to better communicate the census itself or any other initiatives we might have come up for trying to get in contact and gather information about our community. So obviously the biggest discovery vectors were either the Discord itself or through the GRUX Twitter channels. I will note that as of our most recent data poll, Discord has about 470 monthly active users in the last 28 days. So we would definitely like to see these Discord engagement rates go up a little bit. And I do want to have a shout out on this slide to Workplace Share, because that is actually a write-in. So enough people found this survey through it being shared in their work Slack or being shared by a coworker in some way that it represented a decent chunk of our responses. And I just want to say thank you very much to anybody who's sharing this at work, because you're definitely helping us reach to parts of the broader GRUX community who maybe is not as active on social media. So thank you very much. High-level basic demos. The gender breakdown is roughly similar to what we see in the salary survey, so that's not particularly surprising. I will note on the age data, I didn't leave out those who are under the age of 21. We just didn't get any responses from anybody who was under the age of 21. So we would really like to see that particular area have growth in the future. We were heavily leaning into our kind of core demographic. This nice 26 to 40 is heavily represented. And we know that as a network of professionals, this isn't uncommon, but we would definitely like to see kind of in that same trend, more students, more juniors, more people who are younger in the industry kind of interact with us and particularly interact with the survey. Because we know they're in Discord. We would just like to see them answering surveys like the census. Continuing on with basic demos, US is highly represented as a country. That's not surprising either, especially considering that this survey was not localized in the other languages. It was only presented in English. Highest completed level of education. This also maps pretty closely with all of the data we've seen from other sources as well. Large percentage of our community is working with either a master's or some kind of PhD doctorate level degree as their highest completed level of education. Employment status. So this was something we were hoping to get a little bit of a sense for how we can better adjust needs to account for different groups. I suspect that some of these categories are actually higher when you look at the real makeup of our full community, but the group we sampled is overwhelmingly currently employed in the games industry. So let's take a deeper dive on those members of our community who responded to the survey and are currently employed. So one of the things we did ask is to kind of break down where that employment history has been spent. Often we just ask this question as a total amount of work experience, but it ignores the fact that people often kind of jump around from different positions. I myself personally started off in a non-research position within games and then moved into a research position. And so I would be games industry other and then games industry research. And it's nice to be able to kind of break that out, because while I'm proud of that other experience, it's not quite the same and shouldn't be weighed the same as my research experience. So we were really interested to see that, as we kind of expected, research experience is most heavily represented and has some of the longest tenures. We were also really happy to see the amount of people who are coming in with academic experience. I don't have data to show the exact trajectory and path that a lot of people are taking, but it is nice to see that we have some variety. I will note on this slide that around 2.5 years ago, the name of the SIG and kind of the focus of the SIG changed. We broadened the focus of the SIG and adjusted the name accordingly. We did used to be the Games User Research SIG, and then we changed to the Games Research and User Experience SIG, and started to embrace UX counterparts in addition to pure research roles. For that reason, and since that change is still relatively new in the history of the SIG, it's not unsurprising that people with UX backgrounds or doing UX work represent a smaller percentage of the sample who's engaging with our survey, because that change is relatively recent. I will note that of this employed group, 5 people also indicated that while working full-time, they are currently also pursuing another degree or certification while employed. Once again, doing a deep dive into kind of this group of employed individuals, we're also interested in what the kind of org and responsibilities in their job looks like. This is more to kind of better provide guidance to those who are students or juniors who are looking to come up, better understand what kind of needs our current community has. Are these mostly solo researchers or researchers parts of teams? And the data came back that at least for our sample, most people who are employed in the games industry are working as part of a centralized team and are juggling multiple products. Either that's multiple products from a publisher or multiple products from a single studio, they are handling multiple products simultaneously. So to kind of shift gears and look at people's history with GRUX, I think that this particular slide is very interesting and kind of met our expectations. This is why we ran the census right here. We have a large group of people who are, you know, down in that 10 plus category who've been around since the beginning of the SIG, but this less than a year, 1 year, 2 year groups are obviously making up a huge percentage of our current population. And these are the people who've come in recently that we're really interested in kind of getting a sense for who are these members of our community and what their needs are. So it was nice to see some data to back up our hypothesis that our community had been seeing a lot of recent growth. We did also ask of everyone in the census whether or not they've ever held a volunteer role within the SIG. And fantastically, 44 of our 113 respondents have held at least one volunteer role. Many of these people have actually held multiple roles over the course of their time with GRUX. And so shout out to all of you. Thank you so much. I will emphasize on this slide to everybody watching the presentation that GRUX SIG is in fact a volunteer run effort. Nobody here is getting paid for their work. From the members of the steering committee to the members of the summit committee to people running the mentor program and the jobs board and surveys like this and the salary survey, all of it is being done on a completely volunteer basis. If you are ever interested in volunteering your time and finding a way to contribute back to the SIG, if the SIG has done anything to help you, I strongly encourage that. We always welcome new ideas, fresh eyes, fresh energy. So if you would like to be able to be represented on this slide as someone who's held a volunteer role in the next census, absolutely reach out. I'm sure there's something that you could be helping us with. So part of assessing what our community needs and where we might need to grow, one of the things we did want to look at is how aware people are of the current resources and that are available to them from the SIG. So we did kind of gauge awareness of online resources. The Discord channel and the Games User Research Twitter account have the highest awareness and engagement rates. A lot of people were unaware of our YouTube channel. Hopefully that's being improved because of this GRUXonline conference. Welcome to the GRUX YouTube channel. Hopefully you stick around after the conference. We've got tons of videos posted from previous summits as well. So there's a lot of material here for you to go through. Also a high level of unawareness of our jobs board and our jobs Twitter account. So do be aware of those and follow those, especially if you're a student or you're job hunting. Or if you're in a hiring position and you have a position open up at your company, please take advantage of those as well. But this kind of gives the steering committee a little bit of guidance for where we could maybe do some better advertising for ourselves. And here's again a note, we currently have over 1,000 members on our Discord. So it is really not, and most of our users came to us from the GRUX Discord or the GRUX Twitter account who filled out this survey. So those groups being so heavily represented kind of jives with the rest of the data. Another area of awareness we kind of probed on was SIG events. Obviously we've got a high level of interest in both of the summits. That's great, we love to see it. We have a lower level of awareness of things related to GDC, considering that GDC is often prohibitively expensive. That makes sense. If you said, I'm totally unaware of non-summit in-person events, well, that's because pretty much none of them have happened. We were kind of interested there in more assessing for future surveys. Hopefully this is a bit of future-proofing of our census. We would like to see more in-person events, though obviously at a time when we can actually gather in groups and aren't in the middle of a global pandemic. So part of the steering committee's job is reaching out to members of the community and providing them with information about what's going on. So we did want to probe on where people are getting their news sources. So this is a good slide for anyone at any part of the SIG that's attempting to reach out to people, either to provide them with information or to encourage them to interact with things like a survey or to submit for things like conferences. The most commonly used news sources are Discord and Twitter. Social media posts from other GRUX members is also pretty high up there. Absolutely, we see you, Facebook group write-ins. Do not feel embarrassed if that is where you get a lot of information about GRUX and what's going on with the SIG. We will continue to meet you where you are, and we'll continue to make sure that really important information does get posted there in the middle of all the shit posting. So we will continue to find you there, don't worry. But yeah, if you're trying to get information out about anything related to GRUX efforts, probably Discord, talking to Sib about getting something on the Twitter account or retweeted by the Twitter account, or just engaging with other GRUX members on social media are all probably really good ways for you to go about that. So here's kind of our final slide, because we had two questions on the census that, I will be blunt, aren't actionable by the steering committee. These are the types of questions that I always tell my devs I'm never going to ask in a survey, which is the, it wouldn't it be nice to know questions, and then here I am guilty of putting them in a survey. So number one is opinions on SIG name change. As I mentioned a little bit earlier in this presentation, about 2.5 years ago, or at the time of this, when this survey was conducted, it was a little less than 2 years ago, the name of the SIG did change. We went from GUR to GRUX GRUX. And so we were just interested in kind of doing a barometer on how people felt about the name change, whether they felt that it had had positive impacts or negative impacts. And as you can see, community is still mixed on it, with the majority of people answering in the neutral. Considering what a large percentage of the respondents to the survey have joined within the last 2 years, it's honestly not surprising that a lot of people feel very neutral about this, because they weren't around for the name change or weren't around within the SIG when it was under its previous name. As I said, this isn't particularly actionable for the steering committee, but it is something that we've kind of wanted to keep tabs on, and so it's a question we included. Along those lines, we also had a question assessing people's opinions on the current efforts towards unionization within the games industry. This isn't something that the SIG plans on actively campaigning for or against, but it is something that we wanted to kind of get a sense for where our community stands on this particular issue, especially since it's such a hot topic within the industry right now. And so in case anyone was wondering, for the most part, the fellow members of your community, at least the 113 people who answered my survey, were either for or strongly for unionization efforts within games. So that's kind of the end of the dive into the data. It wasn't a very long survey, so there wasn't a ton of data to dig into. And as promised, 72% less exciting than your salary survey. So basically, going forward, what are our goals from here? I'd like to keep running the census annually, either myself conduct it or another member of the steering committee if someone else wants to take over. I think that doing this at a regular cadence is going to be the most important part of conducting a census, because any one individual census is not going to be nearly as useful as data over the years so that we can start tracking trends. And obviously, I would really love to increase engagement. 113 people on a Discord server that is over 1,000 members, I'd really love to see that engagement rate go up. I'd especially love to see that engagement rate increase with some of our more underrepresented groups, like students and younger members of our community. And by younger, I mean under the age of 25, basically. Purely anecdotally, from seeing conversations happen in the Discord server, I believe that the populations of those groups is higher. I believe one of the challenges that I face, or anyone running this census faces, is making sure that our messaging explicitly includes those groups. I suspect that we may have had problems with a lot of people assuming that this census was only intended for those currently employed, which isn't the case. So if you're watching this and you were a little on the fence about the census when you saw it going around earlier this year about whether or not this applies to you, yes, it applies to you. If you are a member of our GRUX community in any way, and even if you're not active on Discord, you're not active on Twitter, you're not even currently working in the industry, I'd still really like you to be taking our census so that we have a better idea of that you're there, that you have your needs, and that we'd like to try and account for your personal needs as we continue to prioritize and work on projects within the steering committee. So, short and sweet, that's the end of my presentation about this year's census. Thank you all so much for coming to my unexciting talk. If you have any questions that you would like to ask me about the data, please feel free to reach out to me on Discord. In the Discord server, you can see me listed as one of the members of the steering committee on the right-hand side. And also, if you have questions that you think would be good to add to future census surveys, also feel free to reach out to me. As you saw at the end there, we had some kind of wildcard questions that we also had in. So we're open to suggestions if you think there's something interesting about the community you would like to know. If you're helping run some kind of little effort within the GRUX community and you'd like an opportunity to ask of a broader group of people to get information to help inform the choices you're making, please feel free to reach out to me. Ideally, the next census would be run sometime around the same time next year, so kind of that late spring, early summer timeframe. And so we have a lot of opportunity to adjust what kind of questions and data we collect. So thank you all again for coming and attending my little talk. I hope you're having a wonderful GRUX Online conference, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.